What's happened? What is this place? Maybe I'm dead. I can't see any light. Maybe I am dead. I can't get up. What's going on? What's happening to me? There's no one here, but these noises. God, my head is killing me. I can't keep my eyes open. The only thing I remember clearly is Charlotte, my doll. No, no, she's freezing. She's alone. Let's look for her. Mummy took good care of Charlotte. She tucked her in, hugged her, gave her cuddles and kisses. She was very affectionate and loving. Nothing bad happened to Charlotte, and that surprised me. I didn't understand. At first, I was quite scared. I was afraid that she wanted to hurt me. I lived in constant fear that Mom would abandon her, because I didn't deserve to live. I didn't deserve to be loved. It's cold and it's dark. Look, she's cold. She'll get ill.
We can take care of her.
Nobody can stop us. Charlotte is a good girl.
Charlotte will be comfy here.
But it's cold. No, it's cold. Don't shiver, Charlotte. The cold will go away. It'll go away.
The cold has gone away now. You see? The light. The warmth. We can do it. The cold will go away. It has to. Now we can enter the ward where everything started.
I was terrified of everything, even thinking. They said they were taking me to a place where the fear would go away, where I would get better. I stopped living in there.
They dragged me away and stripped off all my clothes, everything. I tried to explain what was going on in my head. They tied me to the bed for days. I was alone with my nightmares. It wasn't fear anymore. It was madness. And when you're mad, you cease to exist. She was my only hope in this hell. I was descending down, down among the damned. But that woman and her smile kept me alive.
They said they were taking me.
The door is locked from the outside. Here, the doors can only be locked and unlocked from the outside.
Thank you.
He left, panted and slobbered all over me. It hurt me when he touched me. I thought I'd suddenly split open with a loud crack, and I would be shattered into pieces. I felt fragile, sick, dirty, degraded. All I could do was clutch Charlotte tightly while he... Rene obeyed. He was the master in the realm of light. I was committed by the evil I had committed. I threw up and could feel hell getting closer and closer. My God, those medical examinations. The doctor said there was something inside me which they wanted to drag out of me. My God. She stayed with Rene during those terrible medical examinations, and that gave her the strength to survive. They went to the gynecology ward on the upper floor. August 21st, 1938. Confidential. Dear A, I know what you think about these things, so I'm referring a patient to you, Renee T. This wretched girl got out of control and caused trouble in the grounds. She's almost 3 months pregnant. The nurses should be more alert. I'm examining the girl on the 28th. I'll handle things very carefully, don't worry. We don't want to make matters worse.
Then they said that Renee was crazy, and that the illness was all in her head.
Careful, little girl, careful.
I was scared, and I didn't talk to anyone about the illness. Only her. Not even the other doctor.
He never touched Renee.
He just wrote things down.
You can tell me everything. Don't be afraid, he said. Everything's going to be fine. Do you want to know what I am writing? I note down what I observe in you, everything I see.
He didn't hate Renee. He tried to help her, but he rarely examined her in those small surgeries.
March 12th, 1938. Renee T., 16 years old. Menarche, aged 12. Housewife. Father unknown, mother a seamstress. Admitted in observation yesterday morning from Pontedera, accompanied by a police officer authorized by the examining magistrate of the Court of Pisa to be admitted for a psychiatric evaluation, which I have carried out. Medical certificate. Mental illness preceded by warning signs. Has suffered for a year believing she had tuberculosis. Food deprivation.
We can't read this document. It is forbidden. We mustn't. If they find out, there will be trouble.
We have to look for Amara. We must hurry. We have to follow the memories and make sure they don't fade. She is frightened, hears noises and ghosts, presents serious signs of anxiety psychosis, suffers from hallucinations. She is anxious, confused, her expression is distressed, a questioning look as if terrified, disoriented. She feels confused, hears voices shouting in her head. She doesn't understand things properly. She has been feeling unwell for 2 or 3 months. When questioned, she replies, "My mother wants to hurt me. I am always scared of her. She chases me." "Why are you here?" "I argued with my mother and was so upset that I felt like my head was spinning. There was a woman there who wanted to force me into a life of prostitution. They wanted to condemn me to be burned at the stake. Children whispered, called my name." March 16th. She couldn't sleep last night. They wanted to condemn her to be burned at the stake. April 4th. Transferred to the calm ward, still under my supervision. "Yes, that's true. The ward where Amara was. Yes, the stake. The children wanted to burn Renee. She had to pay for what she'd done, like witches at the stake." April 21st. She's more awake this morning and is responding to questions, complains of headaches. She became agitated when she found out her mother was there. She says that one day, many years earlier, she was with a friend of hers and met a man who made her get into a car and took her for a ride. He made her smoke cigarettes and drink liquor, and the man showed her certain things. He tried to hurt her and made her go crazy. She says he promised to marry her and made her swear to keep what had happened a secret. These facts were essentially confirmed by her mother. After that, she became arrogant, impatient, and hostile towards her family, especially her mother. She started taking off her clothes in public. Her moods would swing from laughter to tears. She rants. She pleasures herself. "I can't remember these things, only the guilt, the stake. I know I deserve to pay for that guilt. I knew it even then." She was uncooperative during the examination. She didn't want to be stripped, and her body remained rigid. Voluntary attention almost totally absent. Probable hallucinations. April 25th. Confused ideas. Unable to maintain a spontaneous conversation. Reflexes all normal. Reactive pupils. "Let's find Amara, and we'll find the full medical records." the grounds at the back of the hospital, and then down to the kitchens. This is the road we used to take. If it weren't for her, in the grounds on that bench in spring, so many days. It was like escaping the nature. She talked and smiled. And then there were the kitchens. Sometimes we stole food and ran back to the bench to eat it in secret, and we laughed. She did things to me. Sometimes she touched me. In the shower, I felt her body against mine for the first time. It was a shiver that warmed my soul. Eyes closed, the light slipped away. She wasn't in the system. He wouldn't let her in. That's it. She must be the key to my memories, to the reasons why. Let's look for Amara in the kitchens in the basement of the building, behind the greenhouse. The land of light was far away, and we spent the days chatting on the stone benches. Come on. Come on, let's look everywhere. She must be here, I'm certain. Keep looking. We mustn't give up. Adele, that little girl has been standing motionless in front of the kitchen door for hours. Poor thing, I gave her some candy. She ate it without a word and remained motionless. I don't think she's very well. We used to see her now and again, but now she's always there. I'm going. The doctor's not here. He's coming this afternoon. Try and speak to him. Poor thing. Lost in her dreams. She was only a little girl. But nobody gave her a cuddle. They punished her instead. They said she was sick and her dreams were troubling her. They weren't even hers anymore. I need her. But we will find her. We'll find her, won't we? When the water in the shower was cold, we ran away. But when it was hot, then she came to Renee under that cruel white light. I can still feel the shivers her body gave me. Everything must return to us. If we recreate that magic, she'll come to us. Everything is ready. We can go to the bathrooms. We can go along that narrow corridor in the kitchens. We'll meet her in the showers, yes. Everything's ready. Let's get undressed and leave our clothes on the hooks in the changing rooms. Let's turn the water on now, and everything will be as before. Amara was everything I could have been, but she no longer existed. I'd have loved to erase everything I did, but instead I always went ahead and did it again. It was my fault, and she disappeared from my life. Gave you injections there, which made your body and soul tremble violently. A whirlwind of anguish and unbearable pain. I lived in terror of the next time. They had taken me upstairs to that ward where no one wanted to go. Look for Renee's room in the slightly agitated ward. When there was too much chaos, they closed all the windows and the door. They turned off the lights, and it was pitch black. Some people fell asleep. Some others stopped seeing their demons and became more calm. Let's close the window shutters, the door, and... They gave you a cold shower. They suffocated you with a sheet. They tied you to the bed. They tied me to the bed. A woman died next to me, choked by her own vomit. She was tied down because she wouldn't stop pleasuring herself. I can still hear her death rattle. I screamed, but nobody came. Everybody screamed in there, all of them. It was then I saw the doll, which wasn't Charlotte. No, she wasn't Charlotte. The past came back to hurt me again in the loneliness of that crowded ward. He brought it with him. I'd never thought I would see him again. He'd come to remind me who I was. That's what my mother used to do. That's what I had done. It seems that my life in here is a repeat of what it was out of here. The dole, the fear, the shame. I'd have loved to erase everything I did, but instead I always went ahead and did it again. Montefoscoli, November 12th, 1939. My dear daughter, it is with great sadness that I heard what happened. Your transfer and your sufferings are a cause of great worry for me. It will take time, but you'll see, things will improve. They'll treat you and you'll get better again. I pray a lot, every day. Write to me often and tell me if you need anything. I promise I'll do what I can. Try to be strong. Mom. This is the last letter she wrote to me. Once I was put into this ward, I was overwhelmed by loneliness. After that medical examination, I received no more letters from Mom. Why is that man here? Why doesn't she come to see me? Did I make a mistake? It didn't seem like she wanted to abandon me. What did I do wrong? I'd like to be able to reply to her again now, to change things. Perhaps she would have listened to me. Will she reply? The letters were sent to the archive. It was their job to post them. When you were sent to a lunatic asylum, you lost the right to possess anything. Everything you arrived with was packed up and stored here, even the clothes you were wearing. In case you were released one day, but far too many never left. Dear Mother, please, I beg you, get me out of this place. I'm so frightened here. You were right. I know I was wrong. I understand. I'm so ashamed. If only you knew how much. But now I'll behave myself, I promise. Now things will be fine. I'll work hard. I'll be very good. Your daughter, Renee. This letter, it was Renee's letter, just as she wrote it back then, but it was never sent. Why? Why did this happen? I received your letter, Mom, and you tell me to be patient and strong while I only feel fear and pain. And you don't write to me anymore. If only these words could be my soul, I'd tell you what was happening to me. The kids want to kill me. They all look the other way and tell me what to do. I don't understand. She helps me, but what have they done to her? Can you tell me? Will you help me? Renee. Monte Foscoli, July 7th, 1940. My dear daughter, I have received no news from you. You haven't even dropped me a line for months. I'm sorry, but I can't afford to come and visit you because I can't afford the fare. Do you remember Mr. Onofrio? He's coming to Volterra on business very soon, and I've asked him if he would be kind enough to ask the director for news of you. I hope when he returns, he'll bring me some good news. Please write to me. I know I was strict with you, but you must forgive me because I didn't realize what I was doing. I've given Mr. Onofrio a new doll for you, as you said you lost yours, and I know you loved it so much. It's not as nice as your Charlotte, but I hope it will give you some comfort. Keep your chin up, my daughter. Everything will be fine, you'll see. Mom. Monte Foscoli, October 12th, 1940. My dear daughter, I've written you two letters and have received no reply, and anxiously await your letter every day. Mr. Onofrio has returned and said he'd given you the doll. Do you like it? He told me he was unable to speak to the director, but he did see you. I pray for you every day. Don Gino said a prayer for you during Sunday Mass. That was lovely, wasn't it? I've made up my mind, Renee. I'm going to bring you home. I've already written to the director to tell him that I'll take care of you. I'm not very well at the moment and can't work, but I'll get better soon, you'll see. And as soon as I'm up to making the journey, I'll come and fetch you. I know you're suffering, my darling, but bear up. I beg you. Mom will come and fetch us, won't she? Mom is good, but she's not well. That's why that man came. She also sent us the doll. I could have played with it and talked to it while waiting for her to come, but Renee didn't bring it with her. Perhaps she's been abducted like all the others and is locked up here somewhere. Let's look for the second doll. It'll be among the bundles of the patient's belongings. Now we can open the bundle on that table in front of the window. You see? Mom was good. I was bad. Mom was worried about Renee and Charlotte. I abandoned Charlotte. We've abandoned her. Let's look for Charlotte. We have abandoned her. Will she still be where we abandoned her, under the warm lights?
I didn't do anything.
I just obeyed orders.
Charlotte has gone away. Mom will come and get us. She loves us, even though we're dead.
Leave us alone.
I didn't do anything.
I only obeyed orders.
Mom will come and get us now.
I only obeyed orders, even though we're bad.
Mom won't leave us alone.
I didn't do anything.
Charlotte gone away.
I only obeyed orders.
Mom will come and get us now. She loves us, even though we're bad.
I didn't do anything. I only obeyed orders.
Thank you. Montefoscoli, December 20th, 1941. Dear Director, could you please let me know how my daughter, your patient Renee T., is getting along? I've written to my daughter several times, but have received no reply. I'm very worried, particularly as I've been ill for some time and have not been well enough to come and visit her. Please kindly let me know when it will be possible for me to bring my daughter home. Your humble servant, Ada T. Bring this letter to the attention of Dr. C so he can assess the potential discharge of the patient. What's happened? What is this place?
Maybe I'm dead.
I can't see any light. Maybe I am dead. I can't get up. What's going on? What's happening to me? There's no one here, but these noises. Can't keep my eyes open.
Writing, sitting at his desk.
September 7th, 1938. The patient frequently indulges in recriminations expressed in an explosive tone of voice. This morning she threw away the milk, saying it was full of urine, spittle, and all kinds of other filth. Crazed, she hears voices that order her to do things. She says she heard children singing and that they were locked up in a school. January 20th, 1939. Introverted, dazed, cannot focus on anything. When questioned and stimulated, she starts crying and weeping. At other times, she laughs. June 1st, apathetic. Eats very little. She refuses to be touched. Does not respond. Spends her time in the grounds. The cooks report that she sits on a bench in front of the kitchens. October 14th. Return of impulsive behavior. This morning she asked for 2 eggs to make zabaioni, but when she got them, she threw them up in the air. Excited, clamorous, slightly confused, takes her clothes off. December 8th. Tied to bed for 15 days. High-spirited, tends to make witty comments and use vulgar words, laughs hysterically and pleasures herself. The nurses report that about 2 weeks ago she remained in the showers on her own and didn't want to leave. They said that when they took her away, she swore at them and then lashed out and bit them. Two nurses had to be treated for their injuries. They've kept her tied to the bed since then. Transferred to the slightly agitated ward from the care of Dr. B to the care of Dr. C. I was with Amara in the showers. My memories are terrifying. They're not real, are they? December 15th. Dr. C. Patient notes. The abnormality of her psychic state has induced her to lead a life which is irregular and tends towards delinquency. Of fickle and flighty character, she regularly discards her household duties and engages in occasional prostitution. Prostitution? Me? No, I don't think I could have. Or are my memories deceiving me? What other horrible things could I have done without even realizing? The uncertainty, the fear of my own actions was one of the things that tormented me most. Her mental deficiency makes her deaf to the reprimands of her family. She has shown suicidal tendencies. She was brought to the ward yesterday, agitated and vociferous. Treated with cardiazol, 2 injections a week for 5 weeks. They were only trying to confuse us with the therapy, and my God, they succeeded. It was as if they wanted to instill the madness into us. June 2nd. After a long period of calm and improvement, the patient is very agitated today and vehemently refuses to submit to a gynecological examination. She swore and cursed those who generated her, flailing her arms and heading out. According to reports by Dr. B, the patient has been subjected to periodic checkups since she had a spontaneous abortion about 2 years ago, in her 3rd month of pregnancy. Conception occurred after she had sexual intercourse with a stranger who sneaked into the hospital grounds. Details are contained in the charges filed at police headquarters in Volterra, a copy of which is attached to these clinical notes. ES therapy. That's how the reality is concealed. It has all been planned very carefully. June 13th. The nurses report that she descended into a state of great mental confusion after receiving her mother's letter. She threw her soup over another inmate because she was very anxious, and then punched a nurse. Impulsive, flails about her. She rails against the doctor in vulgar terms while he is examining her, lashes out and spits. Block all correspondence to give the patient no further reason to become agitated. August 20th, tied to bed. The nurses report that the patient is extremely agitated after the visit of a relative or family friend. 2 days later, she is still shouting all the time that he commands her, that she must obey and harm herself, and that she is not Charlotte. All visits forbidden, constrained to bed, and intensification of ES therapy until we achieve results. No contact with the outside. That way nobody knew what was happening within these walls. March 3rd. Alert, correct attitude, replies when questioned. The nurses report that the patient is calm, she washes and looks after herself. She affirms the existence of a certain Amara. She says that Amara is a patient who disappeared when she was moved to this ward. No confirmation. Probably a regressive hallucination. Evaluate transfer. Did I imagine Amara? That's not possible. She was there. I know she was there. I feel it. She must have left some traces of her presence. We can try to find her medical records in the archive where the letters from her mother were filed. Amara B., aged 32, housewife, mother of two daughters, married to Mario B. So Amara does exist, yet she had no children and wasn't married, but that photo, it's her. June 3rd, 1936. Admitted yesterday, showing signs of improvement. June 8th. Cheerful, calm, and tranquil. Her behavior is good and she's keeping herself clean and tidy. Discharged on June 10th. April 28th, 1937. Arrived accompanied by her husband in an anxious and nervous state. Has difficulty speaking, trembles. Discharged May 14th. March 8th, 1938. A few days before Renee was admitted, she told me that she too had been admitted only a short time previously. Arrived yesterday in a febrile state. Discharged March 14th. She didn't leave. Certainly not after a few days, no. June 22nd, 1939. Readmitted once more, the patient shows rapid improvement. Discharged July 2nd. August 1st, 1941. The latest of many admissions due to agitation. Discharged August 27th. She came and went, stayed only for short periods, but I remember she was always with me. Oh, what's going on? March 4th, 1942. Back again, the same situation. March 8th. Compared to previous admissions, the patient seems depressed even after a few days, although her demeanor is calm and she is attentive. Discharged March 25th. April 2nd. The patient is distracted and apathetic. Her husband brought her here and said, "She's not eating, doctor. She spends all her time sleeping. I'm so worried, doctor. You know her. You can help her." April 6th. Tuberculosis. Patient transferred to the Maragliano Pavilion and is in isolation. May 3rd, 1942. Death from tuberculosis at approximately 8:30 a.m. Is Amara dead? Poor dear friend, I wasn't even able to say goodbye to you. Enclosed is a manuscript written by the patient, probably in a state of delirium. I'm dying, I know it. I'm losing a lot of blood, bleeding internally too. It's strange. Since I came back in here, I can't stop thinking about that little girl with her sad eyes, her desperation. I only saw her for a short time, it's true, but she remains in my heart. Will she still be here?
I hope to God not. I hope she's better and her mother's taken her home.
My memories don't match up. What's the point of this? Perhaps my memory is playing tricks on me. Things are not as I remember them, as I see them. But she said she liked me. I just can't understand it. I just wanted to say goodbye to her for the last time. I never even said goodbye to her. How could a soul survive in this hell? I so want to feel things again. Pain, passion. feel the damn tears rolling down my face to remember that I was alive. I can't be sure it's Amara's. These crosses are nameless. How will we ever know who is buried here? There are no names here. Amara no longer exists. Maybe she never really existed, and I was already dead. Why go on living? Let's put an end to it. I want to leave a letter. I want to apologize for the suffering I have caused. The reception is in the entrance hall. There I'll find a pen and paper to write with. I always wanted to stop doing the things I used to do, but I just did it again and again. I kept on making mistakes, destroying my life and that of the people close to me. My soul was rotting in a state of sin. My life has been one long mistake. I'm so ashamed of what I've done. I lost control and couldn't stop myself, a victim of rage and lust. The most obscene desires. Mom, don't come and fetch me, I beg you. I deserve to be in this place. It's my only chance. But I'm not brave enough to keep on living. Not like this. Not with this shame which wears me down every accursed day. Not with this anxiety which transforms everything into fear. Not like this. But I'll never change, Mom. Never. Let me die, but don't suffer for me. Forget me quickly, but maybe. Maybe you've forgotten about me already. Like everyone else, I thank the Lord. I can't.
Mom works so hard because I have to eat, or I won't grow. There are a lot of them. They want to hurt me. They fly. Even Charlotte can't help me. My baby Charlotte is so beautiful, and she's so good. But Renee isn't. Mr. Onofrio is very kind and helps us. If he's not here, I have good reason to be afraid. When I was little, I never used to sleep. Poor mom. Mr. Onofrio is so nice. I'm bad because I'm not kind. Mr. Onofrio helps mom. How would you manage if you didn't? Mom always has to work because it's so cold in winter. Blackbird's eating my head. That's why it hurts so much. We learn so many things at school, and so we have to attend. How would we get on if we didn't? The others, Mom. Why not? I do a lot of bad things. I don't tell anyone, but Mom knows just the same. Rene's kind to Don Gino, but he always frightens me. A cat goes into my mouth and eats me from inside. At least you can't see what's happening. My schoolmates, when the light's there. What's happened? What is this place? Maybe I'm dead. I can't see any light. Maybe I am dead. I can't get up. What's going on? What's happening to me? There's no one here, but these noises. Is killing me. I can't keep my eyes open.
May 4th, 1942. The patient had previously expressed suicidal feelings, but never acted on them. Yesterday, she injured herself badly, stabbing herself in the stomach with sharp, pointed scissors. Sedated, restrained, and transferred to a restraining cell. May 10th, transferred to the agitated ward for observation. Isolation, insulin, shock therapy. September 25th, positive response to treatment. She replies to questions and remembers what happened, but doesn't want to give explanations. She claims to have memory lapses, entire days about which she remembers nothing. She appears to be anxious and seeks reassurance. She fears she has done monstrous things in the blank periods for which she has no memory. November 11th, 1942. The patient speaks very little, refuses food, force-fed with a nasal cannula. February 2nd, 1943. The lack of kerosene for heating and the food shortage is claiming many victims in the institution. War spares nobody, not even these alienated creatures. Despite her young age, this patient has fallen ill owing to the cold and malnutrition.
Nobody laughs in here. I mean, really laughs. Not those crazy fools who laugh because people say they're mad. I don't know why they laugh out loud. They say I'm mad too, but I never feel like laughing. People used to laugh at me, but they were right, you know? You can't always cry, and people laugh when they're afraid, don't they? It happened to you, not to me. It's better that way. They do that to show they're lucky. You mustn't take offense because it's true. And deep down, it's just like me. It's all shit. You tell me some truth, aren't you? An intelligent person. Just a few minutes. No, come on.
August 28th, 1942. We hereby notify you of the death of Ada T., mother of Renee T., a patient in your institution. No known relative. Sincerely yours, Onofrio P.
I have no one left in the world. Nobody at all.
Solitude is very strange. It muffles everything, slows it down. It's an endless scream that makes no sound. A silent scream. I can't stop looking at myself. I will never leave this place. There is nobody out there for me. These walls have become my skin. And the wretched desperation within them is my soul without a voice. Here, nobody weeps anymore. How I would love to feel life, desperation, anger. I've stopped dreaming, daydreaming, maybe even thinking. I've lived in a reality which has corroded me and has stripped me of everything, even of my ability to feel pain.
May 5th, 1943. Renee's state of health is good. She is eating and speaking. Her spatial and temporal orientation is good. Therapy suspended. December 3rd. She calmly asks if she can leave the hospital. Evaluate patient for 6 months. May 7th, 1944. Discharge denied despite a favorable psychiatric opinion. The patient has no home or means of support. May 4th. The reasons why discharge is impossible are explained, and this is how Renee learns of her mother's death 2 years after the fact. May 5th. She tried to kill herself in the night by hanging herself with a sheet, saved by the nurses. Restrained to her bed, she once more tried to kill herself by suffocation. The decision has been taken to perform a transorbital lobotomy.
10th of June, 1944. Operation successful. Patient tranquil and collaborative. Motor coordination capacity reduced, but she's improving. Transfer to the tranquil department in the care of Dr. B. 25th of October. Continues to talk about Amara and her doll, Charlotte. The disturbances of motor capacity are just slightly walking, not capable of riding, and the nurses report that they have to help her dress, wash, and feed herself. In the summer of 1944, Renee was transferred back into my department. Aware of little, indifferent, hardly ever spoke. One day, she said, "When I find the courage to look at myself in the mirror, I see a young face which is aged and looks at me full of fear." She is a woman now who has changed profoundly compared to the girl that I had under my care several years ago. Only the sadness of her gaze and her intelligence are unchanged. She's so young, just 23 years old. But is lacking all vitality. Perhaps her condition may improve, but probably not. Her life has been thrown away, and nobody did a thing.